Hello everyone, welcome to Virtual Spiritual Saturday. Today we have Pastor Jin Ai as our guest cook.
Hello.
So she will cook?
Yeah, I will be making sloppy joes today. So sloppy joes was one of Rinpoche's favorite recipes. And I would, back then because I was vegetarian, so back then I would make it vegetarian, but because I'm vegan now, so I will be making a veganized version of it today.
So it means we won't have cheese and milk and
Dairy, no animal products basically. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's a good news for vegans.
Yeah. And vegetarians too. And everyone else who doesn't want to eat.
Yes. Okay. So shall we start?
Yeah. So we have in front of us all of the ingredients. Are the ingredients. Yes. So you wanna introduce them?
Okay, we have this you call what, firm or hard tofu?
Yeah. So this is
firm
tofu. And it's hard, not the soft silky type, not the smooth soft silky type. So I've just opened up the packet and then put it in a sieve or in a colander and then let it drain. And then later on I will get Ryan's help to crumble it up. Mm-hmm. So this will actually form what would normally be the mince or the meat in the sloppy joe.
Okay. So and then we have this shiitake mushroom.
Yeah, so we will use about 200 to 250 grams of this. So I have two packets here. Each packet is 150 grams.
So the other ingredient is the patties.
Yeah, so back then, what I would do is to improve the meaty flavor of the sloppy joe. I will use the Morningstar sausage patty for Rinpoche. But I've since come to learn that the sausage patty contains egg whites, so I can't take egg whites.
Okay.
So instead what I did was I got this, which is a naturally 100% plant-based vegan mix. So I got this from a vegan supermarket in KL, in Kota Damansara. It's called Vegan District. And if you are a Kechara member, you actually get a discount on your first shopping with them.
In Kota Damansara?
Yeah. So I got this minced meat from them, and it's vegan. So this is replacing the Morningstar sausage patty.
And then we need also garlic.
Yeah, so I think the recipe, it says 3 to 4 garlic cloves, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, there's 6 in here because I like garlic. So there's more garlic in here.
Okay.
And it's finely minced.
Oh, but for then if those who are doing retreat, then can.
Yeah, so you can just leave.
Yeah, no, vegan is okay. So we have capsicum, red, yellow and green.
Yeah, so red, bell pepper or capsicum. Yellow and green, two traffic light colors. We only use about half of the pepper, right? So these peppers are diced to be
just a bit
a little finer. And then, what else do we have? So we also have butter. This one's vegan, Nutlex. I think there are similar brands, you know, wherever you are, but this one's vegan, so instead of using regular butter, I use a plant-based, dairy-free butter. And then vegetable oil, this one is canola oil. I have here tinned tomatoes, 2 cans, I'm only going to use 1.5 cans. And then I have cayenne pepper, cumin powder, brown sugar, salt. Back then I would use soy sauce or tamari or liquid aminos. Just to give the sloppy joes a nicer, deeper brown colour, but I don't have that today, so I'm using Himalayan salt instead. And then for flavouring, I have ketchup, mustard, regular ketchup, regular yellow mustard, and if I really want to make the tomato-y flavour more pronounced, then I have tomato puree as well. Okay, so sloppy joes isn't a very common thing in Malaysia. The reason why I actually made it for the first time was because Lee was actually feeling a little nostalgic for his childhood favourites. So I went online and then I googled tofu sloppy joe recipes and then came up with this one and made some slight modifications and then made it for Rinpoche, and then yeah, Rinpoche was very happy. So back then what I would do is after serving it in a burger bun, I would also top the sauce with cheese and then that would melt into the sauce. But I'll show you guys that later. Today instead of cheese, I have avocado. Okay, so start later. Okay. So yeah. Oh, I also forgot. One onion, red or white, doesn't matter. Okay, it's just for sweetness and nice onion taste. Okay, so I'm just gonna chop up the rest of the yellow bell peppers. Or wine fiddles with the camera. So after chopping up the bell peppers then, or the capsicum, then we will have to crumble the tofu. And once we've crumbled it, we want to put it into the frying pan with a little bit of oil so that it gets a chance to crisp up, because the last thing you want is having soggy tofu floating around inside the pan. So I'm just dicing up the red onion here. Please don't laugh at my knife skills, thank you very much. I know they're not fantastic. Okay, just gonna shove them to the side. The dice can be quite a rough dice. If you like your sauce to be a bit chunkier, then just don't cut your capsicum up as much. Don't cut your onions up as much, but just remember that they will be in the sauce for a while, so if you cut them too finely or you like basically mash them, they will disintegrate to the sauce and then you won't really get a nice bite when you're eating sausage. Apologies for starting late as well. There's a bin down here, by the way. I'm not just throwing things on the floor. Next.
You want?
Need to break this up.
Okay.
Hold on. Use this. One other thing that you guys can do if you want to make this even drier, is you can take a piece of kitchen roll, and then you can put your tofu between the kitchen, and then just press out the excess water. Okay, so just try and get it as dry as possible. But this one's been sitting in here for like 15-20 minutes, so it's quite dry. But anyway, you just need to like break it up so it looks like a mince, basically. Maybe you want to dry it even more.
Now we have David Chiu.
Yeah.
And
hello.
Sok Fan.
Hi guys.
And Phoebe with us.
Ah, cool. Hello. Wait, which Phoebe? It's not Phoebe.
Phoebe Yong.
Oh.
Ah. Oh, we have mini Phoebe here.
Yeah. And many Cynthia's also.
Maybe only one G9.
I don't think I could take two. Yeah, so mash it up so that. Yeah, this
is it.
Okay. That's good. That size is good. Okay, I'm gonna chop the shiitake.
Who else?
These are fresh shiitakes, by the way, not the dry ones.
Oh, yeah. Pastor Shin also.
Hi, Pastor Shin! Oh yeah, speaking of that vegan supermarket, the other day I went to
the Damansara.
I bought for Pastor Shin Penang prawn meat paste, vegan one.
Oh,
yeah.
Inside the supermarket?
Yeah, in the supermarket. It's so good.
So it's a local, it should be local made.
Yeah, it's a local producer. Yeah. trimming the stems of the shiitake. I assume that the shiitake is in here to add umami to the dish. Mm. Okay, that's what they say, okay? I just follow the recipe.
Yes, normally people, those who want to create those taste of umami, they will use mushroom.
Just so you guys know, the packet for the hard tofu, the firm tofu, it looks like this. Yeah, so it actually says tofu garas on the front. So for what Wayne has just crushed up, I actually used two packets, which was four pieces.
But if your wet market can get those fresh ones, it'll be better, right?
Yeah, of course. There's another brand here. It's quite common in the supermarkets. And they sell what they call firm tofu.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not as hard as this one. This one's a lot harder.
Oh, I know. It's the size is not this type. It's a rectangular size.
Yeah, it's like a plastic packet with a...
Yeah. They seal it with a plastic.
Yeah.
Yeah, yesterday I used that one to still pan frying some tofu.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
Oh, we're here. Okay. So, let me show them what you
so. This is. Okay, can you see what?
This is. Wait, maybe my arms are a bit longer. Just like this.
So,
oh, the video
is a bit slow, I think. More than 3 seconds.
Okay, I need your help, please.
Mm-hmm.
You need this one.
Dough.
To slice and then to finely mince.
So I use.
Yeah.
The chopping board. Yeah, can see.
Can see, right? Yeah, excellent. Yay! Oh, can you please pass me the maybe the plate?
You remove the stem, right?
Yeah. I don't know why. I just see everybody doing it, so I'm just following. I think it's because it's dirty, but
normally you won't wash the mushroom, right?
Yeah. Normally I don't wash mushroom. Because they absorb a lot of water and they themselves are already very watery. So if I wash them, they'll absorb even more water than will come into the cooking and then it will dilute the taste.
Yeah, the texture, everything will be different.
So what I tend to do, if it's like super dirty, I'll use a brush to brush off the soil, or I'll take kitchen paper towel.
Yeah, kitchen towel.
And then slightly wet, then I'll wipe it off.
This normally I will use a kitchen towel.
You know they sell specific brushes for cleaning mushrooms.
Oh my goodness. So professional. Actually, you can see those people who work in the restaurant, how fast and then how skillful they cut those vegetables.
Yeah, but you know what also helps is to have good knives.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, the knives are like really nice. Don't chop it until it's too small, because it will shrink inside the pan. Oh, that's fine. What I mean is when we're mincing it.
Mm. So it's around 1.5 cm thickness, 1
cm. no specific measurement, just try to make sure that they're all the same thickness.
Yeah, or if you cut out, you can't see your muscle if you cut it too small.
One thing is can't see, but one thing is some of it might not be cooked.
What?
Like some is cooked, some is not cooked, if it's different thickness.
Oh yeah. I remember when my mother teach me how to cook. So what she told me was, why you need to, I said, yeah, you just chin chai cut So, no. You have to cut the same thickness so that when it cook, it will be the duration for the time to cook, yeah. Everything will be the same.
That's right. See, my onions, all same size. Sorry, I think I need a plate for this.
Wait, my plate. This medium size is okay, right?
Yeah. Should be.
So your small is my small.
Okay. Onion. Okay, mushrooms are good. So you can chop the mushrooms as well. Chop. You can chop it as size. Basically large enough that when you eat it, there is mouthfeel, like there's a bite, but not so large that basically all you end up tasting is a mushroom salty joke. And I'm sure there's a much better way of doing this. I think you could have done a food processor. Just put the mushroom in the food processor. One shot.
For me, if the potion is not that much, when you use a food
processor,
unless it's a small one, so you know, when you want to just to process this big portion, but you have to wash so many things, so normally you use knife, right?
Okay, fair enough. No, actually, because we could use, what we've done is use a food processor to chop all the vegetables as well. Like, you know, like chop the onion, pepper.
Actually, Pastor Jian, normally what Western food or other type of food you will cook for Rinpoche?
For me, normally Western food, because that's what my taste buds are more adapted to. No, used to. My taste buds are more used to like Western food. But I have cooked a couple of Chinese, really Chinese dishes for the Rinpoche.
For example,
stir fried celery with pickled bamboo and olive leaves. You know the pickled olive leaves that you eat with?
Oh, yeah.
I cooked that with celery. And then pasta lens one, and she was like, that's a really Chinese dish.
And then it tastes really Chinese.
Yeah. So I made that with tomato eggs. Then I made...
Tomato egg. Oh, the way it's really, very Chinese.
It was a really Chinese dish. I did it for Chinese New Year.
For Chinese New Year, for Rinpoche.
Yeah.
Because normally Chinese New Year, including Pastor Jin Ai and some Rinpoche's attendant, will stay back. They won't go back to their hometown and celebrate Chinese New Year. So, especially during that time, you guys will cook for Rinpoche.
Yes, it's nice. I mean, basically, because you know, it's like about 1 week when everyone's gone back to their hometown. And then it's just like a small group of us, so it's kind of relaxed. Like Rinpoche will play games with us, eat
yelling games,
like scare people games. It's so funny. Rinpoche will stand outside the toilet and wait until people come out. And Rinpoche is very quiet. Rinpoche will stand there. Look some videos. Stand there, and then like some people they take a really long time in the toilet, so you can see Rinpoche doing this like. And then when Rinpoche scares them,
I can imagine Rinpoche's expression.
Yeah. And then when Rinpoche scares them, they'll be like, ah! And you know, normally if it's like I scare you or something, right, you will hit me or you'll say something that's like,
yeah.
You know, a bit rude or whatever, right? Because it's Rinpoche, the person cannot say it. So they'll be like, ah! And then they don't know what to do. Because they cannot, like, you know, like, tease Rinpoche or whatever, so they're just. That's why it's really funny.
So who is the how to say, the victim that the reaction is people like to see one?
Pastor Niral.
What?
He has this reaction. You like scare him, you go. Oh sorry, I just hit the mic. Yeah, he will. So yeah, Buster Neuron will get
Is Buster Neuron in front of our camera?
I don't think so. I don't think he has food.
Never mind. I will keep it to him.
Yeah. And one of Rimichi's other favorite so-called victims was Buster David.
So what normally what will he his reaction?
He just jump. Yeah. Yeah. I think Pastor David actually posted a video before. I took the video when he was actually staying in DA at the time.
Mm-hmm.
Then Pastor David was coming in. And Rinpoche stood behind the door. Mm-hmm. And when Pastor David came in, Rinpoche jumped and went at Pastor David, and Pastor David went like this.
Everybody's reaction will be quite different, right?
Yeah. It depends on your personality. Yeah.
Actually, what is the purpose behind Rinpoche doing all this?
Most of the time, all the time. You know, it's a way for us to test and see how our mind works. Some people, you know, if they're very, very aware, it's very hard for Rinpoche to scare them. Because Rinpoche himself is very quiet and very, very fast. Right?
Yes.
So, if Rinpoche is not able to scare a person, then it means that they are really, really aware of their surroundings. Sometimes Rinpoche will see, you know, how big a person's reaction is generally speaking, indication of how big their ego is. Because it's an ego to want to protect yourself because someone came and scared you, something that you're not expecting. Also to observe the reaction of the people all around. Some people, when they observe this happening, they won't laugh because they don't want to draw attention to themselves because they are afraid that next time we reach the opportunity, Rinpoche might do something similar to them, they don't want to be embarrassed. So they won't laugh so loud. Then some people like me, big mouth, will laugh right now.
So then you will kena next time.
I never got.
Oh,
I think because maybe I'm like swan very loud, yes, I don't know. But yeah, Rinpoche didn't scare me. So it's just to see how a person's reaction is an indication of the state of their mind. So we just.
Pastor Singhbell kena before.
Yes, he has.
What is his what was his reaction?
I don't think we can share.
Other than we can.
During Chinese New Year, just small group, so we will cook different things for Rinpoche. And then on New Year's Eve, we will have our own hot pot. So we'll prepare the soup, the vegetables, everything. And then we'll have a hot pot with Rinpoche. And then, as usual, with everything with Rinpoche, usually ends in the Dharma Kanji.
Yeah.
So at the end of the night, Rinpoche will give us a Dharma teaching on something. We'll be talking about everything at the beginning. Like talking about, it's all Buddhist topics, or we'll talk about celebrities, different type of gossip or whatever. Then Rinpoche will show us videos. Sometimes we will karaoke sing or whatever in Nadrang, not going out. And then towards the end of the night, there'll be somehow, some way, Rinpoche will always find a way to introduce Dharma teaching to us. So it was nice because it's those moments like you get very personal one-on-one teachings.
With a small group of people.
Yeah, and because it's very close, we're all very close because we've been together for so many years.
Like brother and sister.
Yeah, so oftentimes the teaching is very, very direct because you don't need to be high saying one because everyone around you knows who you are already.
Yes. No, actually, no need to hide. Everybody knows.
Yeah, she's very, very direct.
Is it, if you notice from video or you have been experienced before, Rinpoche is those public teaching like those in KH will be very, very much different from this type of small group teaching.
Oh yeah, definitely. For me the interesting, unique and very special thing is that even if Rinpoche is giving a public teaching, somehow, although it sounds very general and applicable to the whole audience, there will be a person in the audience who will always feel like the teaching somehow spoke to them personally.
Yeah.
Like they'll feel like always sending them a personal message.
Yeah.
So I mean, you know, when you read in the books, and the books talk about the normal skillful methods and the normal skillful speech, when you see speech, you know, it's the same set of sentence, same set of words in that same order, but it hits everybody differently.
Mm.
And everyone will find something different inside the talk that they can take away with them. Yeah. They will find something that stands out to them more. So last time when Minchi gave a lot of public talks, after the talks, Minchi always like asked us to quick name five things that stood out on the talk for you.
Mm.
So, you know, it's to see the number one if you're paying attention.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing is, because we know the question is coming, so we will pay attention on doing the talk. We not cannot answer the question, right? And then also to see which parts stand out or we pay more attention to, because it's something that we particularly need. Like for example, like if like you know you're very pale or sickly or whatever, then the doctor says, oh, actually you need to take more iron.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, something like that. Like you become more attracted to iron because you are naturally low in iron already. Yeah,
yeah, it looked like for general for everybody, but at the same time, specifically for you, like a personal message.
Yeah.
Like a PM.
Yeah.
It looked like a public post on Facebook, right?
Yeah, it turned out to be a private message.
Then you come up private message.
Okay, so we've actually chopped up all the mushrooms, which is 300 grams of mushrooms. And just so we don't waste extra 50 grams, I'll probably end up using it anyway.
Yeah.
Which is why I asked for the bigger pot. Okay, so now we have all the ingredients prepared. Okay, it's been a while since I've cooked this, got to refer to the recipe. Alright, so we can actually start frying everything now. I'm gonna just open these two cans in readiness. By the way, if you guys are cooking this dish, please wear dark colours. I wear white because of my uniform, but confirm.com, it will splash on you, okay? So you don't wanna deal with bleaching your clothes again and again and again. Okay, these are open. We only need a chopping board. I need more until later. I'm gonna move this too. What's that?
Cool. I hope the ingredient.
Okay, so I can start cooking with this. So do I need to move this here or?
I think so. More to this way better.
But I'll be using this instead.
Do you want to take it?
Yeah. Yes, thank you. Okie dokie. So, how do I tell you something?
Just the taste the lowers. So you need medium?
So I need medium high heat.
Medium to high heat, okay. But so she tapao.
Tapao?
Tapao.
Shin, there's so much here. I still need to give you the banana butterscotch cake. Okay. So about 2 tablespoons of oil. And you can add more later. We can add butter. I like using butter. Okay, so oil and butter. Again, about 2 tablespoons of butter. Wow! Whoa. Okay, actually the first thing I do is I add in the tofu so that it has a chance to get to see. It will splash at you because there's water. Yeah. Just be careful. And it will also take time to get crispy, so be patient.
So we'll cook the tofu first?
Yep, that's right.
to show over there.
So if you're gonna close your eyes, not really, but you're gonna close your eyes, you can imagine how this might replicate the texture of mint, especially when it's crispy. And you can play around, you can adjust the ratio, right? It's all up to you. You can add more tofu if you want and less mint, or you can add more tofu and less mushrooms, or you can take the tofu all completely, just put mint and mushrooms, it's up to you. I'll tell you a really funny story. So whenever I cook for a day, from start to finish, I try not to talk because you don't want to spit in the food or whatever. And I try to, even when I'm cutting and everything, I'll recite either verbally or in my head, Oma home, Oma home, Oma home. So I know this because I know for Rinpoche, food isn't just about the taste, but it's about the motivation of the person who's making it. So if the person who's making it, you know, is in a bad mood that day, or they are they're causing a lot of disharmony or whatever, or they are very sad, or whatever it is, you know, Rinpoche will sense the person's energy inside the cooking. I'll tell you one story. There was one time we were living in Bangkok, in the Bangkok Ashram. And I was on kitchen duty. So my role the whole day was basically to just cook food for everyone. And we had like contractors at the time, so it was like 30, 40 people that I was cooking for. And on top of cooking for 30, 40 people, like 3 meals a day, I was also cooking for Rinpoche and cooking for the ladrang and everything. And then, one day, I was sort of not a very good mood already. So then I went outside to the kitchen, you know, to start my duties. And people started coming to the kitchen.
Mm-hmm.
And their usual habit is they just dump the things and then they run off.
Okay.
And so they don't wash their own dishes. So I woke up really not in a good mood, right? Then the more that kept happening, the more irritated I became.
Mm-hmm.
So up until that point, you know, Rinpoche had no problem with what food I was eating. Everything was fine. I can make like just a plate of tomatoes and make it to play with it.
Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Then that particular day, Rinpoche asked for an omelette. So when I was making the omelette, I was really irritated. Like, all these people keep coming to the kitchen and you cannot take 5 seconds to just wash their own dishes. You know, I was like complaining to myself. So anyway, I made the omelette. I forgot to do all my omelette and everything. Within 5 minutes of the omelette going upstairs, I thought Rinpoche came back down, Rinpoche refused to eat it. So Rinpoche knew that quickly, that when I was making the omelette, I already wasn't in a good state of mind. My mind was really very angry, mm-hmm. and I was already not, you know,
in the right mood to
make offering. Yeah, I wasn't practicing, basically. I could have controlled my mind and not...
So actually cooking is not about cooking on me.
It wasn't about cooking.
Mm-hmm.
It was making offerings to my mama. So as soon as that happened, I knew Rinpoche could already sense it wasn't just about food. So from then on, every time I cook, from start to finish, I just omaha the whole time. And then just keep visualizing that, you know, what I'm doing is I'm making offerings to my guru, I'm making offerings to the three jewels. So I have to have a good motivation the whole time. Cannot be funny, cannot be angry, cannot go and argue with people or whatever. Even when I'm shopping for the ingredients, I'm still thinking the same thing.
Oh, yeah. Either it's a before, during, and after.
Yeah. And then as the attendant is bringing the food in, so you know, make the plate look nice, you know, like make it presentable.
Mm-hmm.
And as the attendant is bringing the food in, I visualize that it's being served and offered up to you. My lama on the altar. That I never had problems after that. So that one time, the omelette in Bangkok, after that I learned my lesson already. So for Rinpoche, when Rinpoche asks people to cook or you know, ask people to serve or whatever, it's not just about the food.
thing. When we just ask you, instruct you to do other things, it is not about the thing you are doing on your work.
Correct. Yeah. But of course, it's cooking up, this is cooking up.
Yeah.
Okay, so the tofu has crisped, I can't say the word, crisped up slightly. Turn on the heat a little bit.
Now, pasta design turn to low heat.
Medium.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
So
medium.
You have red. Yeah. Medium. Go up to what? 1,000 to
2,000.
Oh.
It depends. Not all the induction cooker is the same. Even for our Kechara pasta, they are not only do some writing for our blog. At the same time, they need to teach and kuja and serve and do cooking.
Gardening, farming, social media. Okay, so I turned on the heat. It's crispy. What I'm going to do is I'm going to add a dash of cayenne pepper. If you like it more spicy, add more spice. If you don't, then don't add.
But normally, cayenne pepper will be spicy.
Yeah. Okay. So for me, about 1.5 teaspoons. Yeah. And do the smart thing. Don't put it in your hand like I just did. Because if you wipe your face after this, you are going to burn your face. So measure it out into a teaspoon, like a normal person. Okay, so I mix in the cayenne pepper a little bit so that it combines slightly with the tofu. And then I will add the mushroom thing. Looks a bit like Hokkien. You know, it's like a pattern. Okay, next is the mushrooms. Okay, so I don't add all in because if I add the mince, it will be very much too much. Maybe. Okay, add in the mushrooms. Combine it with the tofu. At this stage, if you want, you can turn up the heat a little bit. If you want to keep it healthy, just fry it as it is. If you really don't care that day, then add more oil or butter. Yeah. But the mushrooms will release water, so let them fry until all the water is gone.
So can they use other type of mushroom?
Can. You can use the brown chestnut mushroom.
Okay.
I would tend to use the stronger tasting mushroom so that the umami.
So you mean this one is a stronger taste?
Yeah, I find shiitake is quite strong tasting. Umami mushroom is very strong.
So if it's better we use a fresh mushroom instead of the dry one, right? You never try that?
I don't try it with the dry one.
Okay, dry one will be really Chinese for me.
I mean, if you guys try it with the dry one, let us know how it turns out. You know, then maybe we can amend the recipe.
Oh man, that's not good. Now we have Abby.
Hello Abby. Hey, this one Abby, this one no cheese on it, you can eat.
Yeah, Abby does not like so much cheese.
Yeah.
But before you become a vegan, you like cheese, right?
I still like cheese. Every time somebody brings up a bottle of water right now, I look at them like... Yeah.
Can you find other replacement for your cheese?
I mean, there is, but when I look at the ingredients, it's not something that...
Not healthy, right?
I'm not always so comfortable to eat, especially the sliced ones. It's like, to like add in all these things about like cornstarch and blah 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 blah, to make it like, you know. So I'm not so comfortable eating it.
Yeah.
Once in a while, like, it's really like, you know, tahan then
yeah,
but
yeah, it's better not.
I think I just eat it like that with rice. Add soya on top, soya sauce.
Right.
And garlic.
Mm, you like garlic.
Actually, this looks like the mapo tofu.
Mapo tofu?
Well, I don't know. That one's faster than.
I thought Pasir Nirai cook mapo tofu or Rinpoche.
Oh,
but Indian style.
Yeah.
That's pretty funny, yeah. I remember Rinpoche commented my Indian food.
Tastes Chinese, is it?
Yeah, tastes Chinese.
I don't know what it is. It's very hard for us to cook authentic Indian food. I think we haven't developed like the taste for it.
Unless maybe we spend many years eating Indian food or throw you in India for many years like that.
Yeah. Okay, so the mushrooms are starting to soften and they release quite a lot of that water. I just keep stirring because I want the water to evaporate because I don't want the mushrooms to be very like soggy. Oh my god, I wish you guys could smell this. It smells so nice.
Yeah, one bad thing about not wedding is yet to develop technology is from the live streaming, you cannot
smell it. Yeah. Ah, with the... Okay. Right, the next stage will be the mince. Okay. should be okay. Okay, so if you guys look at this,
it looks
you'll be creeped out because it looks like beef. It's not beef.
Yeah, just now when I first saw this one, I said, oh, is this beef?
Yeah, like I didn't just go vegan, I went like, eat meat. So, yeah, you can show them.
Yes, you can have a look.
You can use it to make anything, like you can use it to make spaghetti, meatballs, burgers, whatever. Okay, the mushrooms are almost done.
Then we need what? Now.
Add the sausage patties. So maybe about half of the packet of it.
Okay. Actually, we should need how much?
Okay, so I'm gonna push the mushroom and tofu mixture to the side, like people who make char kway teow. Then add a bit more butter before I add the mince inside. Not the mince, we won't get a chance to brown. Right, so you're gonna add the mince. We add half.
Oh, if you're what? Using Morningstar, the sausage, normally you get three, right?
Yep, just three. That's why I'm only using about equivalent of half.
The my god, that's so creepy.
The
yes.
It really looks like beef.
You can. It reminds me of cooking for Halloween.
Make sure the mince is defrosted first before you put it into the frying pan because you don't want it to, again, leak the ice like defrosted and then add stuff.
Actually, can we just pop up this mince? Yeah. We have tofu already, right?
Yeah.
We have protein already.
Yeah, correct. It's good. It's like you got protein and fiber.
Vitamins.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's quite complete. And carbo.
Carb with the bread.
Mm.
I mean, if you use a organic version of this stuff and all that, no less sugar or whatever, it could be healthier. It's so creepy. I think it doesn't look very appetizing. I'm standing here going,
No, no.
So it smells like meat. It's weird.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so just breaking out the mince, and then when it has brown, you know, in certain parts, then I will mix it in with the tofu and mushroom mixture. I'll combine it.
Okay, sure.
And show you guys. So like there's like some bits of the mince that are really starting to like get crispy.
So you are using low heat, right? Low to medium.
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 Medium high-ish. It's on 800. Okay. Combine the two. Don't forget anything at the bottom, scrape up. The original recipe didn't even have the meat, but I just added the sausage patties in because I wanted it to taste more original. If you really don't like to eat like replacements or like meat alternatives, you can just leave it out. This seriously looks like mapo tofu now. Okay. So, now that everything has nicely combined, the next step is to add the garlic, onion, and bell pepper. So I think I will add the onion first. See how everything is nicely browned up. Put the one in first. Yeah, obviously, if you're doing retreat, don't put this in. Slash bell pepper. I'm going to put about half because if I put the whole thing, it's just going to be all capsicum inside. So I'm only going to put about half of each color. So it's a nice, it will end up to be about one capsicum worth of capsicum. Done. Now is the green. And next is the yellow. So again, you can see why it pays off to cut everything to the same size because you want to cook everything at the same rate. Right, so break up the bigger ones that didn't cut through all the way. And last going will be the garlic because the garlic's very finely minced, you don't want it to burn, so I put that in half. And the good thing about this dish, if you're thinking, oh my god, pasta, that looks like so much work, I chopped so many vegetables, had to fry each one by one, why can't I just dump it all in at the same time? Because if you do it one by one, first is you get to caramelize things so you get more flavor, and second of all, think of it as an investment for the week. So like for example, if I was making this for myself on Sunday, I could probably eat this for lunch and dinner every day for like the next 9 days. So it's good for meal prep if you're cooking for yourself. It keeps very, very well inside the fridge. Yeah. So no one said you have to eat it all immediately. Oh, the other thing you can use this for? What? Oh. The other thing that you can use this for is if you're making an omelette and you still eat eggs, you can use it as a filling for the inside of the omelette. So once all of this is cooked and all the peppers and the onions and everything are sauced, you can put it inside the omelette and then it's very easy. This is a very versatile filling. Versatile dish, I guess.
It smells good.
Huh? Yeah. Okay, things are starting to slightly soften. So before they get too soft, I'm going to add in... Wow, yeah, it's 75% of garlic. Don't go crazy. Okay. Oh man. When you asked me what recipe I was going to make today, I was thinking about making the Russian fast food salad. But that would take like 15 minutes. But so far, I'm glad I chose to make this pot food. Oh man, it smells so nice! Okay, fry it off for a bit so that the garlic isn't raw. Like this for about maybe 7 to 8 minutes. And then the next thing we're going to do is we're going to add in the tin tomato. So apparently the key to this dish is making sure that it's like soppy and gloopy and like very saucy, but it's not watery. You don't want it to be, you don't want it to be too thick either, because it's meant to be messy. The thin tomatoes I'm using, they are, I can't pronounce this word. I don't know if it's cereal or cheerio, but it's tofu. So it's chopped tomatoes. If you go to the supermarket, you might see falafel, which is whole tomatoes. Don't get those, get the chopped ones. It should say chopped. Okay, the onions, I don't know if you can see it, but the onions are starting to get slightly translucent, slightly transparent. The raw smell from the garlic has kind of burned off already. They're not as, they're more shiny now, more transparent now. Alright, so at this stage, if you want, you can add in the tomato, the chopped tomatoes, which I think I will do now. I might need some water as well. Okay, so that's one tin in. And try to choose a brand of tomatoes that doesn't have other things added inside. So like no extra salt, no extra sugar, I think it's just tomatoes inside. And so what I did was I added in the first tin, and then I stirred it around, hoping, fingers crossed, that it won't bubble and splash out at me. Go to the second one. There we go. Okay, I actually need some water. Ooh, sorry. apologizing to, but sorry. One minute. Oh, my mic stretched far enough. Keep your face clean. When you're cooking. I'm just about half thin. No, don't rinse out, don't rinse out. Thank you. Okay, so some people like to cook their capsicum a little longer so that it's softer. Some people don't because they like to have the crunch. It's up to you. I like to have a crunch because I don't like to eat baby food. Well, actually, I do like to eat baby food. I don't like to eat soft cut because I need a bit of water. You rinsed it out. No, why did you do that? No. The water actually is like you rinse out the extra tomato then you pour it in so you don't waste the extra tomato juice on the side.
No, I didn't.
That? Oh.
I pour to the other can.
Ah.
It's all inside.
And then I will. Well, now I see the water is making me thirsty. Okay. My dad taught me when you're cooking. You can always add more, wait, what was it? Be careful with salt because you can't, it's very hard to take out salt. But with water, you can always add, take out water. So, just add water if you need to. That's what I do. Okay, so, slightly gloopy. That's not a bad description. Slightly gloopy consistency. If you like your sopijo sweet, add more ketchup. If you don't, just add a bit. So this is about 2 tablespoons. This isn't a healthy dish, by the way, okay? So I'm not even going to pretend that it's a healthy dish. So, I'm just putting in ketchup. It smells really nice. Wine, can you smell it? Okay, can add in a bit of the mustard. That's about 1.5 tablespoons as well. Oh gosh, it smells nice. Stage, you could add in some butter, stir it in so that it's creamy, but I don't think it needs it. And last step, one of the last steps is cumin. So if you add too much cumin, it's going to taste more Mexican or Indian. So don't add too much, just enough to give it a smoky taste, right? So how much am I going to put in? Like this much, so half a tablespoon, something like that. You can always add more in later. Okay, so at this stage, I can smell the ketchup and mustard more than I can smell the cumin. And since I prefer more cumin in my sloppy joe, I'm going to add in the rest of the cumin. So that's about 2 tablespoons, 1.5 tablespoons in total. Oh, better. Okay. Alright. Then, let it simmer like this now for up to 30 minutes, but make sure that it's not too dry. Why are you letting it simmer? Because you want the vegetables to be a little softer. But again, entirely up to you. This is really a do-your-own-way recipe. So, okay, so I'm going to turn the heat down to low and then let it simmer for a bit. Oh, I get myself a drink of water. So for this, when you cook, can we keep in the freezer? Like, if you cook a lot, then...
I think you can, but I think you need to be very careful when you reheat it. Because the mushroom and the tofu might absorb water. And then when you defrost it and then you cook it, the water will leak back out then. So I think when you defrost it, you have to defrost it in the fridge first. And then when you want to actually reheat it for eating, you need to heat it up on the pot, on the stove, not on the microwave. Because you want to stir to mix in.
So that the water
dry up
by cooking with the
sauce. Yeah, or incorporated back into the sauce. Because if you just heat it back up in the microwave, I think the water inside the mushroom and the tofu, when it heats back out, it just stays in the heated liquid. If you heat it in a pan, then mix up even better.
But at least we can keep for 2 meals. 2 days.
This amount for me is about 18 meals.
Means that how many days?
I can eat this 2 meals per day for maybe 8 to 9 days.
A lot.
Yeah, because you're only using like maybe like that much inside your burger.
For one burger lah.
And then if you decide to one, you can use it for other things. I mean, if you decide to cook spaghetti with it.
Yeah, and you can cook spaghetti. But one burger for me is not enough lah.
Oh my god.
I need to take two.
Okay, well, yeah, I guess for some people with large appetites. I'm basically just waiting for the water like that like to evaporate. So there's some water that's still coming out of the vegetables and going back into the sauce. So I'm just waiting for the water to evaporate, get a little bit thicker.
So do we need to do the burger?
We do, but we should... Oh, actually, we can start doing that. Start cutting that. By the way, I didn't use the brown sugar because the ketchup is really quite sweet. So I did not add in brown sugar. But what I will do is I will add in salt. Okay, so how much salt do I want? Pinch, 2 pinches of salt. This one? Yes, like hamburger. Okay, can you give me some kind of coffee? One second. Mm-hmm. Okay. I'm back.
You don't have to toast it, by the way. That's it. Everything's up to you. If you like all your food really soft, it's your fault. So what happens after this is basically you take the hot dog bun and then you fill it with the soppy joe stuffing. Then because the stuffing should still be hot, theoretically speaking, when you sprinkle shredded cheese on top, usually shredded Monterey Jack or cheddar cheese on top, it should melt with the residual heat of the soppy joe stuffing. Toasting. And then that's it, we're almost done. I know wine can't wait to eat this. Okay. So lightly press down the buns to help them make contact with the pan. Crush the buns. One of the other reasons why it's recommended to toast your bun or to butter it is the soppy joe is very moist or very wet, so it will soak through the bread very quickly if you don't toast it. So it'll soak through more quickly if you don't toast it. So recommended to toast. Sorry, there's not much action going on here, I'm just toasting bread. It's really nothing to see. yeah. What else could you do with a sloppy joe? Oh, you could put it in a hot dog bun if you don't have a hamburger bun. Oh, or if you had hot dog bun with hot dog inside, you can put it on top like a chili dog. Yeah, you can do that as well.
Can we make a spicy, really spicy version?
Yeah. I mean, if you really wanted to, you could add chili padi inside. But I wouldn't, because it's meant to be like a kid's meal. So like, if you add like a lot of chili, it's going to be quite hard to eat. You know, so, yeah. Okay. Bun is nice and toasty. There you go. There you go. So I'll turn this off and move this out of the way. And then bring this giant log back into the picture. Alright. Now, how do you serve it? Scoop of sloppy joe. And literally just straight on top. That's it. I know what this is like. This is the guai lo, a more version, Western version of a pao bhaji. Okay, so you can add more filling if you want. I tend to just eat it like this. If you are going to go vegan like me, you're going on the vegan route and you're not going down the, not going down the vegetarian route. Vegetarians will allow you to have cheese, vegans won't, so, well, veganism doesn't. So, what I'll do is I will chop off, thank god that induction cooker turned off so noisy. Okay, so, this is not traditional, okay? So please don't come at us in the comment section and be like, you don't put avocado in a sloppy joe? Well, you don't put tofu in a sloppy joe either, so. Okay, so. Instead of using cheese, which I could do if I wanted to, I could use vegan cheese, but like I said, I'm not a fan of all the ingredients. For that creamy feeling, yeah, I use avocado. So, what I do is slice the avocado. If you're greedy like me, you'll use the whole half. If you're not greedy, then you'll use three. Okay, and then that's it. Cover it and eat it. And that is how you make a sloppy joe. I don't know. You want to take a picture or something? Yeah. Yeah. So that's how you make a sloppy joe. This is not how I made it for Rinpoche, because, like I said, I made for Rinpoche was way more traditional. But this is what I will make for myself these days. Do I have to eat on camera? Oh gosh, no. Okay. Then. Let's prepare for that very embarrassing moment. I'm moving this off. Right, so I learned a trick online. I don't know how true it is, but I learned a trick online that if you want to eat a burger without everything falling out of it, you flip it upside down. So instead of eating the burger this way, you flip it this way. By the way, I would not recommend this particular bun for sloppy joe because, as you can see, it's actually quite soft. So I can feel it's already kind of soaked through to the bottom of the bun. I would go for something sturdier, right? But yeah, let's see how it goes. Oh, jeez, it's supposed to be sloppy. Okay, so I'm so sorry. It's a good thing I'm a fan of my own cooking, because if I wasn't, I'd be in a lot of trouble. It's really nice. I can still taste all the vegetables. It's slightly spicy because I was a bit too liberal with the cayenne, but it's fine. The minced meat is a new sensation because I'm not used to this brand. It's my first time trying this brand. So, I'm not used to it, but it's okay. It's nice. If I'm going to be honest, the part I'm looking the most forward to is getting to the avocado. Because I really like avocado. I know it's not really wine's like slapping your forehead. I know it's not the part that's supposed to sell this sloppy joe, but I like avocado, so. But no, it's nice. Yeah, it's like you can see it's like kind of like flopping all over the place already, but you know. I'm happy with this. Right? Oh, finish. It's going everywhere.
Okay. Thank you, Pastor Jinai.
We'll try later.
Okay.
So it looks nice.
Okay, thank you everybody.
Bye guys.
Bye.
I keep eating this. This is a lot.